a speaker with us from Remera Anglican Church in Kigali. I'm really not sure if I can do it justice to try to introduce him properly. So I'm gonna just say his name and let him come up here and have you guys hear, just how great of a pastor he is. So I would like to ask Pastor Antoine Rutayisire. Welcome.
Good evening, everyone. Actually, it's always a great difficulty for me to speak English when I have a group of Rwandese in front of me, because I get the temptation to fall back into Kinyarwanda, because I know they understand the language, and I speak better when I speak Kinyarwanda. When I was a student in UK some 30 years ago, I had the intention to perfect my accent and speak good standard BBC English. Then I told my professor, because I was writing my thesis on a comparison between the accent of Kinyarwanda and English, he said, actually, I'm going to perfect my pronunciation and speak like a BBC journalist. And he said, how horrible. Imagine a Rwandese who speaks like in English from London. So if you hear me speaking with an accent, it's because he encouraged me to stay Rwandese. So tonight, I want to thank the organizers. And I do it from the bottom of my heart, because it has been said, and I thank those who spoke before me, they made my life easy. It has been said that Rwanda has been slowly rising from the ashes, like that old bird in the Eastern Asia mythology, the phoenix. It used to grow old, and then it would burn, and then it would rise younger. And I think that's what we are seeing in Rwanda. Rwanda is rising. I was born in Rwanda. I grew up in Rwanda. I often tell people I'm a typical native of the land, because I was born there, I grew up there, I studied there, I've always lived there, and the only thing that remains I will do there is to die there. Otherwise, the rest, I've lived in that country, the good and the bad, I've seen it. And I often tell people, if there is something going bad, because there is no perfect country, it can't go as bad as it has been. We are definitely moving in the positive. But very often, people don't see the role of prayer in that. Last year, actually, I did tell you a story about 1994. Those who weren't here, I'm going to repeat it briefly. 1994, on the 5th of April, we were a bunch of dreamers, young people, Christians, who thought we were going to preach to the country and change it by the gospel. And we tried. Actually, I remember one time we went to, this radio that destroyed the country, RTLM? The director of RTLM had been a colleague at the university. We had worked together. I was an assistant professor until they did what they called Kuringaniza, and I was sent to teach in the Tronkome, for those who know the Rwandan system. So you go from the university to a Tronkome, and that's where they sent me. But the guy was a colleague at the university. So we went to see him. We told him, we want to buy airtime on your radio. And he said, we want to see what you want to put on our radio. So we gave him our line. Because you had said you are going to preach the gospel on this radio and dilute their propaganda. So they looked at our proposal and they said, no, we can't sell you airtime on our radio because your line is totally in contradiction with ours. So we were saved from being accused. I'm sure today I would be in prison for having been a speaker on RTLM, but I'm sure it wasn't going to last. But the thing is, that group, we got together, and we, on the 5th of April, it was a Tuesday, on a night like this one. So we went on prayer and said, Lord, what could we do that we haven't done to really stop this country going to the ruins, as we saw the genocide coming? And then the Lord gave us this verse that you find in 2 Chronicles, chapter 7. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, then I will hear from heaven and heal their nation. So that night we spent a night in prayer, and we wrote a leaflet, and we said we are going to mobilize all the churches from east to west, from north to south, and we are going to pray for this country until it is healed. It was Tuesday. Wednesday, we took the leaflet to the printers. The same night, the plane of the president was shot. The rest is history. So the devil had been faster and quicker. But our group, actually the whole group, it was a mixed group of Hutus and Tutsis. All of them got killed during the genocide. I was the only one who survived. And I often tell myself, maybe I was spared to tell people that prayer is going to play a big role in the healing of that nation. And you've seen prayer playing that role. Every week, we meet and we pray for the leadership of the nation. Every month, we meet as leaders in our prayer breakfast and we pray for the nation. Actually, from that time in 1994, I've made it a habit every day, I and my wife. And I'm telling you this so that you make it your culture too. When we wake up in the morning, we sit in bed. Actually, if you want to make a good home, do the same. So the first thing I do when I wake up, I don't listen to the radio. I speak to my wife. And then next, we share what we are going to be doing during the day. And then next, we speak to God. So when she prays for the family and our workplaces, then I pray for the church and the country. When I do it, she does the other part. So we, both of us, we pray. And then the rest is a new day. Make it a habit, not just once a year, but make it a daily exercise to remember your country in the presence of the Lord. You know, one best way of learning to love your country and love its leaders and love its people is to wake up in the morning and you speak about them in the presence of God. By the way, it pays. Yeah, people love you. Very often people tell me, Pastor Antoine, we love you. And they say, well, you don't know why. I bless you every morning. Believe me, it works. So today my life was made easy because those who spoke before me actually took parts of the things I was going to say. Because we have the same verse, arise and shine. And Michael spoke very well about it. Part of what I was going to say, he said it. Then Andrew did the other part. And I'm going to do the last part. Why pray for the nation? Actually, it's for those who have studied French. You know, those who have studied the Fable Dora Fontaine, there is one of the stories, Le Charretier en Bourbée. Do you remember the story? These guys, they were pushing a cart, and it got caught up in the mud. So they were trying to dig the mud and pull their cart out of the mud, and then a fly kept just buzzing around in the ears of the horses. Then the time when the horse was out of the mud, they went to drink some beer, and then the fly just jumped into the glass of one of the people. Say, why did this small thing fall into my beer? And he said, well, I was encouraging the horses too when you are pushing them out of the mud. And I too, I needed a drink. So sometimes when people are busy doing those great things, we just do some buzzing around. I don't know who is the fly, but the thing is, prayer plays a big role in the healing of that nation and the success we are achieving. Although, I don't think there is anybody who is going to get a Nobel Prize for having prayed for the country, but still keep doing it, because in heaven, we will be recognized. So I encourage you to keep doing it. Why do we pray for our nation? Because God says we should do it. Number two, we pray for our nations because it's in our traditions. Actually, for those who have studied the Rwandan culture and history, you know our kings were grouped into cycles. We had a cycle of Kigeli, followed by Mibambwe, followed by Yuhi, followed by Mutara. And every king had a ceremony he had to perform every year to bless the nation. At the beginning of the year, when it was during the reign of Mutara, he would go to Nyabugogo and do the Inzira Yamashoka, blessing the cows of the Rwandese. When it was a Yuhi, he would do the same and do what they call Inzira Yumuriro, just warming up the people, because Yuhi was the king of the people. Then you had Kigeli and Mibambwe, who were the kings of the war, and their duty was to expand the land, because the Rwandese, by the way, for those who don't know what Rwanda means, in our traditional language that they call Urunyakirima, that was the Middle Ages, Rwanda means the ever-expanding country. So our ancestors thought that the whole world is Rwanda. So anybody who is not submitted to the Rwandan king was a rebel, so they had to be conquered. It was the ever-expanding country. But don't take it to the modern times. We are no longer in it. But the thing is, every king had a duty. And the people would join him at the beginning of every year to pray for the nation. When it was a Kigeli or a Mibambwe, they were praying for the expansion of the kingdom. We may expand too, without having to conquer. We just expand intellectually, we expand economically, we expand. So the Lord will grow our influence without having to oppress or conquer. It's just a matter of being a blessing to the people. So we pray for it. Mutara was in charge of praying for the economy. Yuhi was in charge of praying for the welfare of the people. So we do the same. So it's part of our tradition. It's our culture. But when you look in the Bible, you find throughout the Bible, great things happened when people of God started praying. When Israel was in slavery in Egypt, actually in Exodus chapter 2, they tell us they cried to the Lord, and the Lord listened, and he took the decision to take them out of slavery. Prayer was the catalyst of the change. When you read in the book of Exodus, actually, at one point, when the Amalekites came to fight against the Israelites who were going home, God told Moses, go to the hill and sit there and pray and hold the staff of the Lord while Joshua is fighting in the valley. And actually, they tell us that every time when Moses was tired, the Amalekites were winning down in the valley. To the point when Aaron and Hur understood that actually the secret of the victory wasn't in the valley, it was on the mountain. So they held his hands up until the fighting was over. And the Lord said, build here an altar that will remind you that the Lord was the one who was fighting for you. Amen. Against the Amalekites. And you know, when you look at what has been happening in Rwanda, sometimes you see the hand of God writing our history. As a matter of fact, even the victory of the RPF in 1994, you just imagine in 3 months overcoming an army that was probably 10 times bigger. If you don't see the hand of the Lord writing our history, it's simply that you either you don't want to recognize it or you are simply blind to the facts. Because God has been on our side. And God will still be on our side. Because the day he decided to put 12 million people on that small land, as big as a chicken egg, he knew how he was going to make them live and live decently. Despite what we say, there is no single person who is created by his or her parents. It's God who makes the creation. And when he puts us on earth, he knows how he's going to make us live. What we need to do is to be dependent on him and find out what he meant when he put us there. And we as leaders, that's the challenge we have. When God gives you his people to lead, don't trust yourself. Actually, that's what God keeps saying. Don't rely on yourself. You know, those who brought universities and schools, they misled us in some way. Because they started saying, well, now we have PhDs. We don't need God. But you know, one thing the genocide has taught me, MAs and PhDs and all, it's just paper. On the 17th of April, I was living in my own home, my own house, with my wife. And we had to leave the house. And some of the things I left behind included 2 master's degrees, license from the National University of Rwanda, and we just left, and we went. And that day I understood that the wise, the ignorant, the educated, and the non-educated, without the hand of God, your education doesn't save, doesn't rescue. And just to add something, those people who burnt our land and destroyed our people, many of them were my colleagues at the university. They were very bright. It's not that they were ignorant. It's not that they weren't educated. It's simply they were sinners without God. And when God tells us to depend on him, he knows what he's going to do. So that's why we have to pray for our countries. And what do we pray for? This one, the others didn't speak about it, so that's why I'm going to finish, and then we pray. Andrew spoke about King David. Actually, King David is a good model of a leader. Although he had many weaknesses. Actually, he was sinful in many ways. But on the other hand, he was a good leader in the sense of the kind of spirit he had. If you analyze David in terms of weaknesses, he had plenty of those. But when you look at the positive side, he was a strong king, mainly in his dependency on God to bless Israel. And when you take Psalm 144, it gives you some of the things we need to pray for when we are praying for our countries. Psalm 144, 144, from verse 10. He made a wonderful prayer, and he says, to the one who gives victory to kings, who delivers his servant David from the deadly sword, deliver me and rescue me from the hands of foreigners, whose mouths are full of lies, whose right hands are deceitful. And you know, when David was praying, he always prayed to be a leader who is not deceived. Because when, as you rise up in leadership, you are surrounded by people who want to influence you. And among those, there will be many deceitful people, many liars. And I don't know how it works. Those guys, they know how to maneuver their ways, and they always do things. And David was saying, God, be on my side and give me the wisdom and the discernment to know who is who around me. And that's something we need to pray for. Pray for our leaders for wisdom and discernment. Many times you hear Africans saying, you know, we had these superpowers and so coming. And David was saying, protect me against those foreigners who will come to influence me to do the wrong things. And then he said, then our sons, actually many of you sitting here, then our sons in their youth will be like well-nurtured plants, and our daughters will be like pillars carved to adorn a palace. I like this verse. You know, the Rwandese are handsome, and the girls are very beautiful. And David was saying, let our young people grow to be material for construction. Let our system of education produce people who are going to be constructive rather than self-destructive or otherwise destructive. Is that a good prayer? So when you wake up in the morning, pray for our system of education and pray for our young people. Because once our system of education, actually that's one of the areas you are still struggling with. Once our system of education is perfected, then you will see a nation rising like an eagle. We still have a long way to go in that area. I mean,